I would like to invite our next guest, and he'll be speaking on another important topic, that is the change of public opinion in the favor of Palestinian cause. And for that, we have our guest directly from Gaza. He is Dr. Rafaat Alareer. He is an academician, and he is the editor of the Gaza Right Facts and also an author. So I would like to invite him to come forward and present his thoughts.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me. Thank you for organizing this amazing talk. Very important speech. It's very important to keep the dialogue moving on when Palestinians stop dying, stop being killed by Israel, and stop being massacred. Because sadly, what usually happens is that many people pay attention to Palestinians when they're being massacred, and when the quick killing stops, many people turn the other way. So thank you very much. And I'm really honored to be here with Professor Sami Al-Arian and Dr. Mosheer Al-Masri. It's very important to notice that so many things have changed in the past five years, I would say, probably around the time of Trump, around the time of 2014, when so many people saw how brutal a ruler like Trump, supported by many racist dictators like Netanyahu and other people around the world. For us as Palestinians, we have been hurt. We have been hurt the most by Trump. And we're not selfish to say this, but he did so many things. He supported the massacring of Palestinian freedom marchers in Gaza in the Great Return March. He gave Jerusalem as a capital to Israel on a golden platter. And when the killing started, when Israel started killing Palestinians, Trump was like, Israel has the right to defend itself. So this kind of marriage between dictators, between brutal, mindless, heartless rulers, made people like pay attention to what's going on in Palestine. It's like, oh my God, if Trump is supporting Israel, it must be it's because Israel is bad, not because Israel is wrong. I want to build on what Professor Sami just said. This is not something that started a month ago or 2 weeks ago. And people who start from 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago with the invasion and the horrible, barbaric invasion of Al-Aqsa Mosque and the bombardment of Gaza, those who want to start here want to start the story from second. They don't want to mention Israel, the occupation, the siege, the apartheid regime, the racism. They want just to make people blame the victims for reacting to the brutality they are facing. So with the invasions of Al-Aqsa Mosque in Ramadan, in the holiest month, the holiest day, the holiest place in Palestine, more and more people, and we've seen this on social media, I've seen many non-Muslims or non-religious people saying, oh my God, how can Israel do this? Why is Israel doing this? Does Israel think the world is blind, attacking Muslims in Palestine in their holiest place, in their holiest month? And these questions are important because people start seeing Israel for what it is, a racist apartheid regime. And there's something I like always to highlight. Just 2 weeks before Israel invaded Al-Aqsa Mosque, Israel attacked and brutalized Palestinian Christians in Jerusalem, prevented them from celebrating Easter, attacked them. We've seen this videos and pictures. So this is a war against Palestinians, whether Muslims, Christians, or whatever. In Gaza, what happened is also important. Israel deliberately and systematically attacked homes, attacked buildings, residential buildings, and whole blocks, attacked high-rise buildings. We've seen this, the whole world saw this. And Israel, for example, when Israel attacked the media tower, the most important media tower with Al Jazeera and Associated Press. And this, by the way, this place houses dozens of Palestinian small businesses and startups. So when Israel destroys this building, it destroys thousands of jobs, hundreds of jobs. Thousands of kids are going to be with less food or no food because of what Israel did. When Israel did this, it was flexing its muscles because it showed the world that we can commit any crime because America and Europe support us. Nobody is going to punish us, and we are not, there will be no consequences. But Israel did something interesting. They called the owner 10 minutes before or 15 minutes before and told him, hey, evacuate. And you can't evacuate. What are you going to evacuate? Because all the equipment, all the, you know, computers and the machines and everything are going to be left behind and destroyed. On the same day at night, Israel massacred 42 family members. So during the day, Israel called the owner of the tower and told him, evacuate. We're going to destroy this building. And at night, when nobody is seeing, no cameras are there, Israel, without any warning, without calling anybody, destroyed a whole residential block, massacring 42 Palestinians and injuring around 100. And when we speak, the total number is now 354 Palestinians, and almost 2,000 Palestinians were killed. And those 2,000 Palestinians were supposed to be killed. Only a miracle from God saved them. So it shows how Israel wanted to kill as many people as possible. When Israel did this, when they targeted the Al-Qolak family, Abu Al-Awf family, and one of them is a student of mine and Dr. Mosheer, Zainab Al-Qolak, lost 17 family members. There is this little kid, so heartbreaking. Israel killed him, killed his father, killed his grandfather, and killed his great-grandfather. Four generations. This is extermination. This is genocide. This is not we toning it up. This is what's going on, ethnic cleansing and genocide against native Palestinians. And with the deliberate destruction of the infrastructure, the roads, the electricity, the water, the sewage lines, the internet access points, the medical centers, the Gaza's only COVID-19 testing center was destroyed, was damaged, was out of order because of Israeli attacks. Now, all of this was being broadcast to the whole world, partly on social media, but partly on mainstream media, but most importantly on social media, on Twitter, on Facebook, TikTok, on YouTube, on Instagram. And because Palestinians have accumulated this amazing experience of exposing Israeli crimes, and Palestinians have been working with a global movement of struggles around the world. We have millions of people around the world on social media supporting us and tweeting and retweeting and posting. And this is how the change of the public opinion in favor of Palestine started to be. It started slowly, probably around 2014, when Israel killed 2,500 Palestinians, including 551 kids. And the whole world started to see this. And we saw the real change. For the first time ever, celebrities, footballers, models, actors, politicians started condemning Israel for what it is, what it's doing, the massacres, the crimes, the attacks against civilians, because the people were seeing everything, not on mainstream media, but mainly on social media. Many of them started opening their eyes, starting asking the right questions, started condemning Israel for its apartheid regime. Now, I'll talk about three points here in the change, where we can see that change. So in addition to the social media and the millions of people around the world supporting Palestine and Palestinians, the New York Times published four very important pieces. And when we talk about the New York Times, this is a Zionist institution, an institution that has demonized, dehumanized Palestinians, that almost literally copy-pasted Israeli army press releases as if they are news. Always eliminated Palestinians. But this change, this pressure, probably because of this pressure, but there could be like, there is a disagreement between Palestinians and pro-Palestinians. Why is the New York Times doing this? But four pieces, I posted a piece. Can Israel, my daughter asks, can Israel destroy the building in the dark? About how I'm trying to calm my kids down. How I'm trying as a father to explain what's going on to my children. And a Palestinian lawyer, Diana Bato, published a very powerful piece on the myth of coexistence, where she said, no, There is no coexistence in Israel because Israel doesn't want non-Jewish people to be there. And the wonderful piece by Layla Al-Arian, Professor Sami's daughter, my grandfather bought a home in Gaza with his savings, and Israeli strike destroyed it. Also powerful. So many people were amazed. Why is the New York Times doing this? And finally, 3 days ago, they published the pictures of all the children killed in the latest Israeli war. They published the Palestinian kids and also the two Israeli kids killed. 66 Palestinian kids were killed. And there was an uproar. Many Palestinians and poor Palestinians are still doubtful that the New York Times is doing this because it is riding the wave, because now Palestine is a trend and it brings more clicks and hits and readers and, you know, subscriptions. And some believe that this could be, it is 37 years late, but it is something good. It's good that at least Americans are being exposed to what's going on in real life. But the Zionists and the pro-Zionists were furious. So many of them, again, they were, everything the Zionists did, it exposed how evil they are, how horrible, inhumane they are. And many of them said, okay, we are going to end our subscription to the New York Times, only because the New York Times started humanizing Palestinian kids. If you post the pictures of killed kids, kids who were killed, and you don't like this, it means you are a horrible person. And everything, every move the Zionist propaganda took, it was even worse. They were like in a hole and digging themselves even deeper. In addition to this, so many Palestinians were on mainstream media, on the BBC, CNN, DW, Professor Sami was on TV, Dr. Mosheer Amer was so many times, I was so many times, Ali Abu Nirma, and so many young Palestinians for the first time were speaking for Palestinians. For decades, it was always Israelis speaking on our behalf, or non-Palestinians saying what we feel, what we should have, what we should do. But now it's Palestinians who are speaking to the world. It's true that news anchors are usually like Israeli officers to us because they adopt Israeli propaganda, Israeli lies and fabrications, and they usually interrogate us. But despite that, we managed, Palestinians and pro-Palestinians managed to speak truth to power, to say that this is not about today or the rockets. For example, I was asked a question on the BBC, why don't you stop the rockets? I said, it's not about the rockets. The rockets are like 10 years old. And Hamas is like 30 years old, but the occupation is 73 years old. And there are no rockets. There is no armed resistance in the West Bank. And Israel killed, many people will not believe this, perhaps. Israel killed almost 30 Palestinians in the West Bank. In the same time, it killed 250 Palestinians in Gaza. And there are no rockets. There is no armed resistance in the West Bank. So this is, Israel is like, I say this many times, Israel is not against, only against Palestinian resistance. Israel is against our very existence. Israel doesn't want us to be here. In addition to this, like footballers, like I just mentioned, مثلاً, Riyad Mahrez, Mohamed Salah, Bella Hadid, and Gigi Hadid, and Dua Lipa, and Mark Ruffalo, and John Oliver, and politicians, amazing pro-Palestinian politicians. I'll mention some of them in a bit. We're tweeting about Palestine, retweeting issues and articles about Palestine. And this takes the message, the Palestinian cause, to millions and millions of people. And I'm following this trend, like people who have never tweeted anything about Palestine, people who have never been exposed to Palestine, when they saw what's going on, they immediately started supporting Palestine. And this is amazing. We need to build on this. So why is this the change? So there is a lot of change. Why is this change happening? Number one, we've seen, I'm not sure how many, but around the world, I would think that millions of people were out in the streets, took to the streets in support of Palestinian human rights. And if it weren't for COVID-19, I think we would see even more and more people out in the streets. Yesterday, I'm not sure how many hundreds of thousands were in America protesting and calling for Palestinian freedom and independence and into the Israeli occupation. So the change is happening for many reasons. Number one, Palestine is a just cause. It's not only a humanitarian cause. It's wrong to say Palestine is a humanitarian cause. It's a political cause. First and foremost, this is about politics. Israel is an occupying power, brutal occupying grace, its power, and this occupation has to end. And in this way, Palestine and the Palestinian cause is part of the global cause around the world, the global struggle against racism and discrimination. And it's so beautiful to see, like, I am on Twitter all the time, and I see so many people from Kashmir, from places that are black people in America and Africa and are supporting Palestine. Many people in India, in Pakistan, in America, in Australia, in Brazil, in from Europe, supporting Palestine, in Iraq, in Syria, in Jordan. So it's usually those people who have been hurt, who have been brutalized, who have suffered because of discrimination. We always come together. We support each other. Another reason for this great change is the pro-Palestine groups. Like, what you're doing now is amazing. I'm not sure how many people are going to watch this, but even a few people is great. This, we like one or two people, if we influence, reach out to 1, 2, 100 every day, every week, 1,000 every month, that would be enough, because in time, we'll have millions and millions of people mobilizing for Palestine. So such talks, dialogues with Palestinians, whether again in India, in Europe, in America, in Africa, in Australia, everywhere, they help raise awareness. And this is what we want as Palestinians. Because we always say this, Palestine is not a cause for Muslims only. You don't have to be a Muslim or an Arab to support Palestine. You need to be human. And probably one more reason is that for the change is Israel has been exposed more than ever before because of the cameras and mobile phones, again, the social media, as a racist entity. And many people have seen what Israel is doing around the world. Everywhere there is a coup, a military coup, everywhere there is a dictatorship, Israel is supporting them with money, supporting them with weapons. Israel has supported almost every genocide since its establishment in Africa, in South Africa, in Europe, in Asia, everywhere. And finally, there is an important reason. We've seen how America is the root cause of the problem because of how it supports Israel with money and politics and weapons. But the young American politicians, especially in the Congress, with the new caucus, Black caucus, and the people of color, those people did an amazing job for Palestine. We expect more from them, but what they did is a good start. Hopefully, this is going to escalate for them calling for BDS, boycotting, and sanctioning Israel and divesting from Israeli businesses. I'll name Ilhan Omar, AOC, Rashida Tlaib, Jamal Bowman, and Corey Bush, and other amazing politicians. So when those people with their great platforms talk about Palestine, how Palestinians are suffering and how Israel is a brutal racist entity, more and more people get the message and become part of this struggle. And now how is Israel reacting to this? Israel has gone insane. And at the same time, it's very tragic what's going on, what Israel is doing, how its social media accounts are, you know, in a way celebrating the deaths of the massacres against Palestinians. But sometimes I pity them because they have become like a teenager, demonizing Palestinians at the same time and justifying the massacres. And then, oh, we are poor, please support us, stand with us. We are being hurt by Palestinians. So Israel escalated its systematic methods of demonizing and dehumanizing Palestinians. Lying and fabricating. There are so many videos, so many pictures, so many cartoons Israel did that are lies. Yesterday there was a post about Israeli war minister using a picture of a hospital from Pakistan, trying to to lie and fabricate and tell his audiences that, look, Palestinians are using this hospital for military purposes. This is what Israel is. It was built on genocide, on fabrications and lies, and continues to live on genocide and fabrications. And many people started to see this. The other thing Israel and the Zionist lobby did was use the anti-Semitism card. Anti-Semitism is categorically condemned by Palestinians. Anti-Semites have no place in the Palestinian struggle, Palestinian movement. But most of the anti-Semitic incidents that happened were fabricated or either taken out of context, where two guys are fighting, and then they say, look, they are targeting the Jews here in Europe or in America. And again, the people started seeing how Israel is doing this. Now, finally, what's going on now? There is a ceasefire in Gaza, right? But Israel continues the occupation, continues the siege, continues suffocating Palestinians, preventing import and export, invading Al-Aqsa, killing Palestinians. Yesterday, 2 days ago, I think, they killed, they shot and dead a Palestinian teacher in the West Bank. And that's why in Palestine, we say, during a ceasefire, Palestinians cease and Israel fires, because Israel continues to kill. And when it comes to the rebuilding because of the destruction of thousands, tens of thousands of homes and housing units and businesses were damaged or and schools and clinics were damaged or destroyed. Research has shown that Israel has always benefited from destroying Gaza. And this is important. 80% of the aid that came to Gaza for rebuilding went back to Israeli economy, because Israel says you have to buy the cement, the building materials, everything from us, and we have no choice. And the people has to know this and expose Israel for what it's doing. So Israel is destroying Palestine, destroying Gaza, and Israel is being paid for destroying Gaza. It's like, thank you, here are $3 billion for what you did to Gaza. So Israel is importing the occupation, and the Palestinians get poorer and the Israelis get richer. Now, finally and briefly, what do we need to do? Again, the occupation hasn't ended. We need to continue the struggle, continue the awareness. We need to continue spreading the word, reaching out to people we know and people we don't know. Palestine is not a Muslim or an Arab cause. And honestly, we did, and I'm sure Dr. Mosheer and Professor Sami agree with me, we did more talks with non-Muslims and non-Arabs than we did with Arabs. And this is, in a way, it's very, very good, great, but in a way it's sad, because we need more Arab brothers and sisters around us. Briefly, one, please go to social media, follow Palestinian accounts, listen to them, see what they have to say about the struggle, about their fight against racism. Because usually mainstream media hides 99.99 of the truth. Listen to them, follow them, wherever they are. Engage with them, ask them. And as something Dr. Mosheer mentioned, it's BDS, boycotting Israel. Boycotting Israeli companies, Israeli services, Israeli applications, Israeli goods, and also boycotting the companies that benefit from Israel. There are many companies that help the Israeli occupation. If you know about some of these, boycott them. Probably you can go to bdsmovement.net or the Intifada, Electronic Intifada, for more resources about this. So you can ask Palestinians and they will give you lists of companies that benefit from the occupation and help the Israeli occupation. We need people to support us online. It's important, by tweeting, by posting, by sharing, and also in real life. And part of this, finally, real life change is the pressure we need to put on politics, on politicians. We need to call them, to talk to them, to ask them what they think about Palestine and what they can do to help Palestinians. And honestly, I'm not saying this only about Palestine, because Desmond Tutu says, injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere. If we stand, prevent injustice in Palestine, we can stand and prevent injustice everywhere, in India, in Kashmir, in the Arab world, in Africa, in Asia, in Latin America, and everywhere. So this is what I have for this point. This great change in real life, in the support, and on social media, the popular level and the official level. And hopefully we can invest and build on this in order to affect real change and end the Israeli occupation in Palestine. Thank you very much.